So without further ado, we are blessed today to sit at the feet of Dr. John Warwick Montgomery. With 11 earned degrees, three of those being doctoral degrees, Dr. Montgomery is Emeritus Professor of Law and Humanities at the University of Bedfordshire in England. He is the Distinguished Research Professor of Apologetics and Christian Thought with Patrick Henry College here in Virginia, in the United States.
Correction. As of this year, it is no longer Patrick Henry College, and this is going to make everyone feel very comfortable. It's Concordia University, Wisconsin.
All right. Yes. So that is one of the reasons. Well, France is his primary location for where Dr. Montgomery dwells. He is spending this semester and every fall semester at the Concordia University, Wisconsin, in Mequon, Wisconsin, doing some teaching there. So we were able to get him to travel a little bit south from Mequon to be with us today. He is also the director of the International Academy of Apologetics, Evangelism, and Human Rights in Strasbourg, France. And by the way, I'll invite you, when you're at the table where Dr. Montgomery is signing books, you'll find these wonderful pamphlets that describe that very enterprise, the academy, especially students and pastors, anybody. You may be interested in checking that out as a possibility for your own enrichment. His legal specialty is the international and comparative law of human rights, and he regularly pleads religious freedom cases before the European Court of Human Rights. He's a citizen of both the United States and the United Kingdom. I assume that's still correct. All right. He's authored over 50 books in 5 different languages. With such a pedigree, it's not surprising that he is considered the foremost living Christian apologist. We're blessed to have him join us today. Join me in welcoming Dr. John Warwick Montgomery.
All right. Today we are dealing with a lawyer's defense of Christianity. Now, that seems a little anomalous, considering the fact that I believe in a recent survey, lawyers here in the United States were placed along with used car dealers at an exceedingly low ethical level. I give you 2 stories that may connect with that. A boat sinks in shark-infested water, and 3 of the survivors, a doctor, a lawyer, and a clergyman, are on a raft, and there is an island fairly close, and one of them is going to need to swim to the island in order to get help. And they cast lots. The lot falls to the lawyer, he dives into the water, and 2 sharks converge on him from either side. The clergyman begins praying and the doctor covers his eyes, but the sharks draw parallel with the doctor, with the lawyer, each puts a fin under him and deposits him safely on the island. "A miracle," cries the clergyman. "Perhaps," says the doctor, "but it seems to me it's just professional courtesy." And then there's the story of the boundary dispute between heaven and hell. It seems that there is a fence and a covenant to repair, and certain sections of this fence are to be repaired by the devil and others by the Lord. And the Lord is out walking, and he sees that the fence is down in the devil's section. So he goes back to his office, telephones, and says to the devil, "Are you aware the fence is down and it's your problem?" Devil replies, "Nya, nya, 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 nya." The Lord says, "Listen, this is a serious matter, and if you don't do something about this, I'm going to sue." The devil, "Nya, nya, 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 nya." The Lord says, this is a serious matter, I'm going to sue." A lawsuit is never a laughing matter. Devil says, "It is when all the lawyers are over here." Now, why then a lawyer's defense of Christianity? Why not perhaps a dentist's defense of Christianity? Well, there are several reasons for this. One is a remarkable number of great scholars of the law, professors of the law, judges and practicing lawyers have been Christian believers, and they have become Christian believers because of their examination of the evidence for the truth of Christianity. I mentioned a few of them. Hugo Grotius, who is the father of international law. If you study international law, you always begin with Grotius. He also did a little book entitled De Veritate Religionis Christianae, The Truth of the Christian Religion, one of the early Protestant works of Christian apologetics. Sir William Blackstone did the first textbook of the English common law, his commentaries. And at the beginning of the commentaries, this is what Blackstone has to say. He says, upon two foundations, the law of nature and the law of revelation in Holy Scripture, depend all human laws. That is to say, no human laws should be suffered to contradict these. Blackstone says, you've got to start and you've got to finish with what God has revealed in nature and in Scripture. Simon Greenleaf was the greatest authority in the 19th century on evidence in the American common law. He did a treatise on evidence, which has been influential ever since. And it was used also in the law schools of England. And Greenleaf did a little book. It's titled The Testimony of the Evangelists. As it were, he put Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John on the witness stand to see if their testimony to Jesus Christ would hold up in a common law court. And his conclusion is, absolutely. Today, in our time, there has been Sir Norman Anderson, who did a little book, A Lawyer Among the Theologians, and a pamphlet arguing legally for the truth of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I knew Sir Norman and did lectures with him. Sadly, he has passed away. On the European continent, Jacques Ellul, E-L-L-U-L, who was professor of law at Bordeaux and was a very, very serious, believing Calvinist Christian. These people arrived at Christian faith because they examined it with the care of a lawyer. And it so happens that lawyers are in the evidence business. I took theology before I took law, and one of the reasons I went into law was that, quite frankly, neither pastors nor theologians are specialists in proof or evidence, but lawyers are. And this is of such importance that, at the present time, there are philosophers who argue that if philosophy operated as the law operates, the philosophers would get a great deal farther in solving ultimate problems. Two examples of this are Stephen Toulmin, you probably not heard of him, and Mortimer Adler. You surely would have heard of Mortimer Adler. Adler, along with Robert Hutchins, created the Great Books of the Western World, published by University of Chicago Press. And these two gentlemen, both of them, argued with great emphasis on the value of a legal style of reasoning, even in the domain of philosophy. And I'm going to read a quotation or two from those two gentlemen. This is from Stephen Toulmin. To break the power of old models and analogies, we should provide ourselves with a new one. Logic is concerned with the soundness of the claims we make, with the solidity of the grounds we produce to support them, the firmness of the backing we offer. Or to change the metaphor, with the way we present the defense of our claims. The legal analogy included in this last way of putting the point can for once be a real help. So let us forget about psychology, sociology, technology, and mathematics, ignore the echoes of structural engineering and collage in the words ground and backing, and instead let us take as our model the field of jurisprudence, the philosophy of law. Logic, we may say, is generalized jurisprudence. Arguments can be compared with lawsuits, and the claims we make and argue for in extra-legal context with claims made in the courts, while the cases we present in making good each kind of claim can be compared with each other. Very interesting. And Mortimer Adler, who converted to Christianity not long before his death, said this, "If I am able to say no more than that a preponderance of reasons favor believing that God exists, I can still say that I have advanced reasonable grounds for that belief. I am persuaded that God exists either beyond a reasonable doubt or by a preponderance of reasons in favor of that conclusion over reasons against it. I am therefore willing to terminate this inquiry with the statement that I have reasonable grounds for affirming God's existence." This is legal language. Now, why is it that the philosophers are impressed with legal reasoning? Well, the reason for this is that legal reasoning is based upon probability considerations. In a civil case, in the Anglo-American common law, if you can show evidence that outweighs the evidence of the other side by even 1%, if you have a 51% advantage over the other side, you're going to win the case. And the evidence is the evidence that is admitted into the court in order to determine the results. In a criminal action, percentage is a great deal higher, as it should be, since in the case of criminal actions, it isn't just a matter of paying a fine, let's say. It can be imprisonment or where capital punishment is employed, it can mean the very life of the person. So in criminal actions, in order to arrive at a conclusion that the defendant is guilty, the jury has to be convinced to a moral certainty beyond reasonable doubt. Now, that doesn't mean perfect certainty. It means reasonable certainty, probability. And as the Federal Rules of Evidence of the United States puts it, the issue is probability. Probability. Fascinatingly enough, the philosophers have gradually come to the conclusion that that kind of reasoning is the way philosophical and religious questions ought to be decided. Why is this? Well, during the history of philosophy, many, many systems have been presented as explaining the universe. From the ancient Greeks on up to modern times, one system after the other. In the case of science, there have been many different theories presented, but earlier theories are eliminated on the basis of experiment and evidence, which will lead one on from those theories to better explanations. The peculiar thing in philosophy is that all of those philosophical systems that have been presented through the centuries are still there. They're still on the table. And so philosophers known as analytical philosophers at the beginning of the 20th century said, this can't be right. We have got to develop criteria to verify or to disconfirm philosophical ideas. And therefore, we need to work out ways of doing this. And these analytical philosophers concluded that there are really only two kinds of argumentation. One kind of argumentation is purely formal, and it derives from the presuppositions or assumptions that we happen to have. This sort of reasoning is employed in pure mathematics and in deductive logic, for example. When you took plane geometry, remember the thrill of taking plane geometry? When you took plane geometry, you were able to write at the end of a proof QED, quod erat demonstrandum, which must be demonstrated in this fashion. Why? Because your entire proof derived from the axioms of plane geometry. You first accepted these axioms, and then to prove something, all you had to do is to show the conformity of the proof to the axioms. That is what these philosophers called analytical reasoning, but it's possible only in situations where you can derive your conclusions from self-evident assumptions. In all other cases, There is only one way to demonstrate a claim, and that is to get off your derriere, off your rear end, and go out into the world and investigate the facts, and to see whether the facts conform to the theory, or whether the theory has to be modified in order to meet the factual test. There are, these philosophers said, also a third kind of assertion, but if it's neither analytic nor evidential, then it should be classified as nonsensical. One scientist, Wolfgang Pauli, the physicist, wrote in the margin of a colleague's paper, "This isn't right. It isn't even wrong." There's something worse than being wrong. It's making statements that can't be tested in any way whatsoever. They can't be confirmed or disconfirmed. Right? Now, the philosophers are beginning to move in a direction of legal reasoning, because legal reasoning does not attempt perfection, as in deductive logic or pure mathematics, because it's dealing with matters of fact. And where matters of fact are concerned, you collect the evidence, you weigh it, and you determine whether it justifies theory A or theory B, or whether still another notion would be preferable. If we come to see this, then the question is, turning to religions, what would be the result if we examine their claims along the lines that lawyers use to examine the claims in courts of law? And that's exactly what we're going to do. We obviously can only do this in a very cursory fashion, but I think I can show you what the results will be if you employ reasoning of this kind. First of all, as background, I'm going to be looking at Christianity in these terms. Why, you say, are you doing that? Doesn't that show your prejudice? No, it doesn't, because the difference between Christianity and other religions is at exactly this point of evidence. Other religions make claims just like the great philosophers have made claims across the centuries, but they do not provide any means of testing. There is no testability available at all. Muhammad, for example, said, there is one God, Allah, and Muhammad, that is to say myself, am his prophet. All right? Well, that's a claim, surely. How can that possibly be justified? If you go to the Quran and you look at it, it has lots of peachy moral principles and some other things that surely would not be classified as peachy moral principles. But in any case, it doesn't offer any way to verify or validate the statements that Muhammad has made. Indeed, anyone could make claims like this. It has occurred to me occasionally that if I emphasized that my books on the book table out there are really there by divine inspiration, it could increase sales. Yes, yes. But there doesn't happen to be any way that could be shown. Okay? This isn't right. It isn't even wrong. When we go to Christianity, we find an entirely different situation. In Holy Scripture, we have statements such as that of St. Paul. If Christ did not rise from the dead, we are of all men most miserable. We've been deceiving others and we are deceiving ourselves. Paul says there that the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead is a watershed factual issue. Either it occurred or it didn't. If it didn't occur, that's the end of Christianity. If it did occur, that's the best ground for accepting it. There are fulfilled prophecies of the Old Testament, splattered all over the Old Testament. I'm going to be talking about this a bit in a Sunday school class tomorrow morning. These prophecies come to fulfillment in Jesus Christ. And this kind of thing is a historically verifiable situation. Let's take the case for Jesus Christ specifically. The case for Jesus Christ depends upon the documents which are collected in the New Testament. These documents would be accepted, would be admitted into evidence in any common law court. Why? Because they fulfill two characteristics. They are fair on their face, that is to say, they don't have any internal evidences of corruption or prevarication, and they have been found in a place of natural custody. What does that mean? It's a magic legal expression. It simply means that the documents have turned up where you would expect them to turn up. A number of years ago, after Howard Hughes passed away, a Howard Hughes will was found among the Mormons in Utah. Now, this will come as a surprise to you, I'm sure, but Howard Hughes had never had any contact with the Mormons, as far as we know, at all. This will was not in a place of natural custody and was not admissible for that reason. Okay? There was no evidence to connect it with Howard Hughes. In the case of the New Testament documents, these are found exactly where they should be, and investigations have shown that these documents were the product of apostolic writing, or they were produced in apostolic circles, and therefore they connect with the events that are described in them. Okay, so the documents would go in. Then the court would leave it to the jury to determine the weight of value, the weight of importance to be attributed to those documents. Admissibility just gets them in. Then it's a matter of looking at them to see how valuable the content is and whether the content is of such a nature that we can arrive at a positive conclusion concerning what they say. This, by the way, is exactly how any historical documents are evaluated. So, what do we find in the case of the New Testament documents when we look at them from the standpoint of the weight of evidence that ought to be attributed to them? Well, as we've already said, these documents are primary source records. They come from people who had immediate contact with the events. How do we know this? Well, I'll give you just one illustration. We have two students of the Apostle John, and John told them not only that he had written the gospel attributed to him, but that Matthew's gospel was written by Matthew Levi, the tax collector, who was an apostle. Mark's gospel was written by John Mark, who was a companion of the apostle Peter. And Luke's gospel was written by the physician who accompanied St. Paul on his missionary journeys. Classical historians would sell their grandmothers for this kind of corroborating evidence in behalf of the value of typical secular documents of the ancient world. Years ago, I had a debate with a professor of philosophy at the University of British Columbia. He said, I can't accept Jesus. These documents are no good for that purpose. So I laboriously went through the history of these documents and showed that the manuscript evidence is infinitely greater than that for the secular classical works of the ancient world. Caesar, Cicero, Suetonius, Aristotle, and so on down the line. And I said, you can give up you can get rid of Jesus by throwing out these documents, but before you do this, you have got to throw out your entire knowledge of the classical world, because that knowledge is based upon less adequate documentation than what Christianity has. Said this professor, all right, I'll give up my knowledge of the classical world. At which point, a professor of classics jumped up and said, good Lord, not that! You know, I mean, what would have happened to his tenure, for example, under those circumstances? The fact of the matter is that the documentary foundations of Christianity are impeccable. The reason why one cannot disallow this stuff is because of a cross-examination principle of great importance. The New Testament scholar F.F. Bruce at the University of Manchester years ago said, the presence of hostile witnesses while these documents concerning Jesus were in circulation was the functional equivalent of cross-examination in a court of law. What did he mean? He meant that if the writers of these documents had been presenting fables about Jesus. If the miracles that they say he performed, he didn't perform, and the prophecies that he fulfilled were not fulfilled, do you seriously think they could ever have gotten away with it? These documents were in circulation while the very people who had crucified Christ were still around. If they had taken the trouble to crucify our Lord, surely they would have refuted prevarication in these documents. Their presence, the presence of hostile witnesses who had means, motive, and opportunity to blow the whistle on the apostolic writers and did not do it, shows simply that they couldn't do it. There's a principle in the French Civil Code which goes something like this. It says, if a witness has not responded as any reasonable person would to a claim, his non-response to the claim is evidence against him. The fact that the Jewish community, the Jewish religious community, had every reason to destroy Christianity and would have been able to do it just by showing that the presentation of Christ in these Gospels was incorrect and did not do it, counts heavily against them and heavily for the documents that we're talking about. It's a functional equivalent of cross-examination. Now, let us say that you go along with me to this point. What we have then is solid documents with solid witnesses who say that Jesus claimed to be God Almighty come to earth to save mankind. The question then, the $64,000 question is, how do we know he was that person? How is this different from Muhammad or from Father Divine in New York, you know, some years ago? You would meet him, you'd say, and who are you? And he'd say, God. And then a few years later, there was a tragedy. God died in New York. Why is the picture of Jesus and the claims of Jesus on a different plane? Well, there is the matter of the fulfilled prophecies, which I cannot go into here now. I'm going to be talking about that a little bit tomorrow morning. The central reason for accepting this is that Jesus gave one sign that this would be so, namely his resurrection from the dead. He said, only one sign will be given to this wicked and perverse generation. As Jonah was in the beast, so I will be in the earth and I shall rise again. And after he rose again from the dead, they remembered this, and people who hadn't believed on him before believed on him then. How do we know the resurrection occurred? Well, first of all, the witnesses to the resurrection are the same people who give us all this other information about Jesus. It would seem very peculiar if suddenly they suffered a screw loose somewhere at the moment when they're describing the very end of Jesus' life. These are witnesses that, as we've said, are believable, and these witnesses, therefore, we have no reason to think would not be presenting an accurate picture of the end of Jesus' life as they do of his ministry in general. But beyond this, we have the very detailed information about his death and his resurrection. Jesus very definitely died on the cross. There is an article published some years ago in the Journal of the American Medical Association, the JAMA. A medical specialist, a theologian, and a historian dealt with the details of the crucifixion. And the conclusion of this article is, there is no question but what Jesus died on the cross. All right. Then, during a 40-day period, he appears again and again, and he appears physically. He eats with his disciples, and one doubting fellow, Thomas, won't believe even though his fellow believers say that they have seen Christ and had contact with him, and our Lord appears and allows Thomas to touch the nail prints in his hands, thrust his hand into his side. This was a physical resurrection. Well, what is the opposition to this that one comes across these days? Well, one example of opposition is the position that holds that because this would be a miracle, there is no way it could be demonstrated at all. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Does this mean, therefore, that it doesn't make any difference what the probabilities are? It doesn't make any difference what the evidence is? We simply can't go along with a resurrection. Well, if any of us knew the universe so well as to be sure that miracles cannot happen, then I suppose you could argue this way. But in order to argue that, you would have to check under every rock in the universe and make sure no miracles were happening there. And you'd have to do this in the past, and you'd also have to do it in the future. And of course, none of us is in that position. Indeed, we are living in what Einstein called a relativistic universe. It's a universe in which nobody has a knowledge of natural law that is so comprehensive that he or she can say certain events can't occur. The only way to find out whether events occur is to get off your derriere and get out there and check. And if the evidence is good enough, you have to go along with it. Otherwise, you're like that farmer who had had contact only with pigs and chickens and geese and cows, and he was taken to the zoo, and suddenly he saw a giraffe. And he said, "There ain't no such animal." The giraffe didn't conform to anything he'd already seen, and therefore it had to be rejected. That, of course, is sticking your philosophical head into the sand and refusing to recognize what the world is all about. A mature person expands his perspective in the light of expanded knowledge and expanded evidence. We've said all the way along that lawyers are concerned with probability. The arguments against the resurrection are often of a very different sort. For example, Fundanikin, years ago, did a book entitled The Chariots of the Gods. And there was also Schoenfield's work on Jesus. And these books say, in effect, Jesus was probably from outer space. He was from outer space. And creatures from outer space can do things that we can't. I mean, things like, say, resurrections. And therefore, the way to explain this is to regard Jesus as different from everybody and anybody else. Well, of course, he was, but not in that sense. Now, I give you a legal parallel to this. This is the old mansion at Gopher Gulch. And the police hear the ugly rumor that there has been a crime in the mansion. And so they go to the mansion in Gopher Gulch, and they find an Agatha Christie-style locked room. No windows, locked from the inside, all this and that. And inside the room is the victim, cut into 18 equal-sized pieces. And next to him, the accused, the future accused, holding a bloody axe. Well, the accused, of course, is tried, and the judge instructs the jury. And this is how the judge instructs the jury in most American jurisdictions. He says, you can only bring in a guilty verdict if you are convinced to a moral certainty beyond reasonable doubt that he did it. And that means you've got to be able to exclude all other explanations of the crime that are consistent with the evidence admitted in this case. If you can exclude all other explanations, then and only then can you bring in a guilty verdict. Jury retires, they come back in a fairly short time. And the clerk of court asks for the verdict, and the chairman of the jury panel says, "We find the defendant innocent, Your Worship." Your Worship wakes up for the first time in some time, and he is of course horrified. He's horrified, and he insists on an explanation. And the chairman says, "Your Worship, this is a mysterious universe. It's a contingent universe where anything can happen. Since anything can happen, it is certainly possible, isn't it, that invisible Martians entered this room, and because they didn't like the poor defendant, they cut this fellow and the other fellow into 18 equal size pieces, and they gave the bloody axe to the fellow, and he has his fingerprints on it. Because this is a genuine metaphysical possibility, we find him innocent. The judge would have had apoplexy. He told these nincompoops that they were not to take into account anything but admissible evidence, what had been admitted in the case, and then to see what kind of explanations of the crime were possible within that frame of reference. And they were to make their determination in terms of probability, not in terms of possibility. As one philosopher has said, anything is possible but squeezing toothpaste back into a tube. I mean, it is a very, very mysterious universe. And under these circumstances, it is not possible for us, we cannot arrive at explanations in terms of what might conceivably be the situation. We have to act in terms of solid evidence based upon the facts at our disposal. And in the case of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the conclusion is clearly that he did, in fact, rise again from the dead exactly as he promised. Now, if that's so, what are the implications of it? What are the implications of it? The way in which we come to this conclusion may be the same as we would use in trying to determine whether Caesar crossed the Rubicon or whether Napoleon died, whether he lost at Waterloo or whatever. But here the implications are something else. Why? Because if Jesus rose again from the dead, then that vindicates what he has said about himself. Namely, that he is God Almighty and the Lord of life and death. And it means that his way of salvation is going to be the only way of salvation. If he says one is saved in a certain fashion, then there isn't any argument. This is God Almighty. And it therefore establishes a solid religious foundation for time and for eternity. And what did he say about all that? Well, he said the problem with the human race is self-centeredness. He called it sin. And the people of this world through the generations have been more interested in themselves than they have been interested in anybody else. They have not loved their neighbors themselves, and motivationally, they can't be brought to do this by any kind of manipulation or technique. People cannot climb up to heaven by their own bootstraps. In the Old Testament, which Jesus validated by his stamp of approval, you have the Tower of Babel. That's the symbol of a fallen humanity, trying to build a tower that'll go up to heaven, climbing up, 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 up. And what happens? They obviously cannot do this, and even their language is confused. Their ability to express themselves adequately is confused. And Jesus says, that's the condition of humanity. And the only answer to this is, out of love, God Almighty comes to earth and takes the sin, the self-centeredness of the world on himself, expiates this on the cross, rises again to prove that he is the Lord over death, and salvation is available to anyone who will recognize that he can't save himself and will rely upon Jesus for salvation. That's the heart and essence of Christian faith. And that faith differs qualitatively from all other religious and philosophical positions in two ways. First, as we've already seen, it is able to be validated. It can be confirmed. It's something you can know is a factual truth. Secondly, unlike other religions and philosophical systems, it will not allow man somehow to pull himself up to heaven by his own bootstraps. It takes human nature seriously and realizes that unless there is a loving God who has died for us, we are all up the metaphysical creek without a paddle, and there will never be a way that we can satisfy the divine requirement of perfection. So, Christianity, looked at from a legal standpoint, gives us a solid religious foundation based upon evidence and a way to deal with this endemic problem of self-centeredness. People can be changed, but they can be changed only by Jesus Christ. In the New Testament, it says if any person is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. And it's that promise with which I leave you this afternoon. If you have entered into that relationship with Christ, you know that it transforms your existence and you no longer look at other people the way you did before. If you haven't come into that relationship with Jesus Christ, please consider this seriously. Eternity is a long time. And it was Pascal in the Pensée who said, there is enough evidence for anyone who wants to see the light. And there's also enough darkness for those with a contrary disposition. So one needs to do a little self-analysis. Do we want to come into that kind of relationship with God, or don't we? I pray that we do. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, without further ado, questions and answers. If you have a question, I invite you to come forward to the mic that you'll see right here at the center aisle so that everyone will be able to hear your question and then hear Dr. Montgomery's response as well.
Yes, just before the program started, we were talking about people who, instead of doing this, instead of coming up to the microphone, wait and then attack the speaker individually. Now, listen to me. There are only two kinds of questions, good questions and bad questions. If the question is a good question, the rest of the people here deserve to hear it and to hear the answer. If it's a bad question, why should I deal with it in any way whatsoever?
So, yes, please ask questions. Yes.
So, like your thoughts on the continued effectiveness of the legal argument in today's society. The reason why I ask the question is some of the points you put forward with regards to beyond a reasonable doubt and probability. I've been a jury just on regular civil and criminal trials here in St. Louis, and I find that the jurors struggle with things like beyond a reasonable doubt, probability. This isn't even religious, this is just about, you know, regular cases. Mm-hmm. It seems like the jury tends to feel like, you know, unless there's some video or photo of something that actually, you know, records the actual event, that nobody can really make decisions about anything. And then you get the conspiracy theories and all sorts of things in there. So I guess to boil my question down is, given our modern society and sort of the way they think, maybe its logic has broken down, I don't know. But I mean, is there a greater difficulty today using that legal argument with today's society?
I think it is more difficult today owing to the fact that educational levels have dropped. People tend to get mesmerized by television and by journalistic activity and that sort of thing. And unfortunately, in our modern culture, people are not taught to think. And what goes on in court is an effort, really, on the part of the judge to get the jury to start thinking clearly about this critical matter. And he does not always succeed. Some years ago in England, where you cannot do any jury research, this is against parliamentary law, the bailiff happened into the jury room, there was something matter with the toilet, I don't know what, and he noticed that the jury were there looking at a Ouija board, which one of them was working with, and they were trying to get the decision by way of the Ouija board. Now, This is, of course, bizarre, and the sorts of problems that you talk about are awkward and troubling. But listen, this issue of religious truth is of such a crucial nature, because eternity depends upon it, that surely if we're ever going to be reasonable in the way in which we arrive at a conclusion, we need to do it here. And if we have any tendencies toward making our decisions using a Ouija board, for goodness sake, let's put that aside where the issue of Jesus Christ is concerned. Too much is at stake. We're not saying people will automatically go with this reasoning. The title of this was A Lawyer's Defense of Christianity. But I would hope that you will agree with me that this kind of approach is a valid approach and one which ought to be used, even though not everybody is going to fall naturally into it. By the way, this gives me a chance for a story. This was a historical story, however. At the time of the French Revolution, the philosopher Talleyrand was met by another philosopher, you never have heard of him, La Chevalier. And La Chevalier was trying to start his own religion, because this was a time when Christianity was being rejected for deism, deism, and this sort of thing. And this wasn't going very well. And La Chevalier wanted Talleyrand's advice. And Talleyrand said, "It seems to me that Jesus Christ, in order to found his religion, first died and rose again on the third day. You could at least do that much."
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for being here today. This question came up a little bit over lunch, and I think we came to some semi-resolution, but this comes up a lot for me, and so I'm wanting to get your thoughts on the balance between using apologetics and maybe the function that it serves, while at the same time knowing that we cannot argue somebody into the faith, and that's the work of the Holy Spirit. So what would you say is, and actually this kind of objection, it seems, to apologetics has come from some of my Lutheran brothers as well. So I'm kind of wondering the correct balance with that.
Yes, this is a very good question, and this is the reason why, incidentally, that the kind of apologetic presentation you've just heard, you will not hear even in seminary classes among our Lutheran brethren in most instances. There is a Lutheran feeling that somehow arguments like this take away from the work of the Holy Spirit. Okay, let me help you with this, all right? First, the third article of the Creed and Luther's explanation of it are right on key in terms of Holy Scripture. Nobody is saved through his own efforts. Salvation comes through the work of the Holy Spirit on the heart. This, however, is independent of the question of the evidences that one presents in order to persuade people to consider the truth of Christianity. All right? One could say that it's the Holy Spirit behind any arguments for the faith. One could say that, but one doesn't even have to say that, because once the person gets to the point of a decision, and makes that decision, Scripture says that if that decision is positive, it is solely the work of the Holy Spirit. Now, this is mysterious, there's no doubt about it, because Scripture says if you decide against the faith, you have only yourself to blame. As Luther put it, there's plenty of free will to go to hell. There's no problem with that at all. But free will is not capable of carrying you up to heaven. You say, but this is paradox. Yes, it is. But wouldn't you expect some paradox at the point of the connection between the divine will and the human will? We don't even understand our own will, right? Ask any psychiatrist, psychoanalyst, for goodness sake. We don't even understand our own volitional activity. And this deals with the connection between human volitional activity and God's activity. In short, the best seminars on that subject will be given in heaven. You sign up at the gate, and that'll be taken care of nicely there. All right? Now, let me illustrate this with the New Testament. The Philippian jailer says to St. Paul, "What must I do to be saved?" Right? if some of our pietistic Lutherans were right, Paul would have replied, there is not a single thing you can do to be saved. Haven't you read Ephesians, my letter to the Ephesians, one of my best works? There I have said in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. There isn't a single thing that you can do to be saved. Next scene. The Philippian jailer has hanged himself. Paul's response to that question is, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. And in the Greek, that's the aorist, meaning do it now, don't wait for spring. This is a calling for an immediate act of belief. But then, once the Philippian jailer believes, then Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 enters into the picture so that by his own experience, the Philippian jailer, or by the instruction of pastors and the like, he'll come to the conclusion that this was not something he achieved. It's something that is 100% due to the work of God's Holy Spirit. And I hate these people who say, oh, this is decision theology, decision theology. Listen, no preacher ever got into the pulpit and presented a sermon without expecting people to do something about it, right? I mean, otherwise, why bother? I mean, is the pastor up there just talking to himself? The whole idea is to get people to act in accordance with Holy Writ and the rest of it. If they do, they can't take credit for it. That's the Holy Spirit. If they don't, it's their own damn fault. Okay?
That helps. Thank you.
Okay.
Good afternoon, Dr. Montgomery.
Yes.
There's a lot of myth and lore surrounding the Isles, and I was wondering if you can make the case that Jesus Christ visited the Isles.
Was a what?
Wondering if you can make the case that Jesus Christ visited the Isles. There's
statement.
A lot of myth and lore surrounding the Isles.
Specifically, which isles are you referring to?
Well, the British
you're
isles.
You're talking about the Hebrides, yeah. and this sort of thing?
Yeah, and Britain, Ireland, Scotland, Wales.
Well, this is awfully easy because there's not one whit of contemporary historical evidence to the effect that he was ever there. Now, all of us sing, and we weep as we sing it, the wonderful English poem by, by 18th century poet, when Jesus walked in these grassy fields and so forth of England, and if only England can become Christ's domain again and all this kind of thing, but there is no historical evidence that Jesus was ever in the British Isles.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and you see, here's my problem. Religious decisions and historical decisions have got to be based on evidence. They can't be based on what we'd like to have the case. Okay?
Okay.
Thank
you.
William Blake's Jerusalem.
I'm glad it came to you right now rather than 2 a.m. like it usually is.
You would have been the first person I called.
Yeah.
Yes.
I have a question. I'm involved in Jewish evangelism. I actually go into synagogues and witness, and if I'm not kicked out, I speak. But at any rate, one of the things that comes up repeatedly is this notion of the afterlife. Sometimes I get the impression amongst Jewish people that if there is an afterlife, there's a heaven and everyone gets in. When Jesus spoke in the New Testament, he spoke pretty convincingly about hell. And no one that he spoke to said, well, what's hell, or could you explain that to me? But in the Jewish, I guess, theological construct, you have Olam Haba, the world to come, you have Sheol, and a little bit you might have Gehenna, which literally means the Valley of Hinnom, which is where people were sacrificed to Moloch, and there was kind of like a garbage dump running through that.
Sure. Okay, I go with all of that. What's the question?
The question is this. If you appeal to hell, if you're going to say that there is a hell, The best way to try to get that across to a Jewish people is to say, well, if there isn't a hell, then where did Hitler go? And then it's an emotional appeal. Is there a better way to go about that?
Well, the Old Testament is not awfully specific in regard to the afterlife as compared with the New Testament. And it seems to me, and I would go about this differently. I would try to show that Jesus is indeed the person he claimed to be. When he was before the high priest said, "Are you the one?" And Jesus said, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with all the heavenly host." And he was quoting there from the apocalyptic passages in Daniel and Ezekiel. This is the divine Messiah, all right? Now, if Jesus is the divine Messiah, and a Jewish person accepts this, the Jewish person gets two things. The person gets salvation. Messiah has come. This is not something one is just looking forward to at some point in the future. Salvation is immediately available. But secondly, one gets one's Old Testament back with a divine stamp of approval on it. You know, the problem for the Jewish person is that there are not solid Old Testament manuscripts close to the time of the events. The oldest Old Testament manuscript we have is the Dead Sea Scroll Isaiah, and that's only 100 years before the New Testament era. So a Jewish person has a terrible problem justifying historically the crossing of the Red Sea, Moses receiving the Ten Commandments on Sinai, and so on, all the way down to the beginning of the Christian era. But if a Jewish person becomes a Christian, then that person receives the Old Testament back with God's stamp of approval on it. Jesus held the Old Testament to be the very Word of God. Huh? So I've always presented those twin appeals. And of course, in terms of the afterlife, one gets Jesus' teaching on the afterlife. Right. Huh? In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. He will eventually wipe away every tear from our eyes, and this sort of thing. That kind of promise is not, you can't find that kind of thing with that degree of clarity in the Old Testament, because the Old Testament is pointing to the new. You've got to have the new to make sense out of it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, Dr. Montgomery. I have a question for you. I have read Craig Parton's The Defense Never Rests, and today's title is A Lawyer's Defense of Christianity. It seems like the burden of proof is always on the Christian. My question for you, is there an eloquent counterpoint to this argument, or even a coherent one that anybody has put out?
I'm sorry, I didn't get the last end of this. Is there a
For the prosecution, if we're arguing this, say, as a criminal case, it's the defense, and we're always on trial. Is there anybody who's actually done something for the other side that even makes sense?
Well, there's the new atheism out at the present time, attempting to argue that there isn't any God at all, this kind of thing. You can find books of this sort without any difficulty at all. But the case that they try to present is dreadful. It is just dreadful. One example of this a generation ago was Bertrand Russell. Bertrand Russell was one of the finest philosophical mathematicians of modern times. And he did a little pamphlet entitled, Why I Am Not a Christian. My goodness, the village atheist could have done better than that pamphlet. It's an embarrassment. It's
an
embarrassment.
As pastor here at Village, I'm hoping this village has no atheists.
Not specifically your village.
Thank you, thank you. Yes, all right. Yes. Thank you.
Any village, yes, all right. Yeah, okay. The important thing here is to note that whoever presents an argument has the burden of proof to justify it. So if the Christian presents his case, the Christian is the one who needs to offer the evidence in this behalf. It is an embarrassment when, for example, I listen to a religious argument where somebody says, well, you can't prove that there isn't any God. Well, I mean, really. really. You also can't prove that there aren't, what, leprechauns, fairies, and I don't know what else. If you present a position, if you offer a claim, it is incumbent upon you to support that claim. Now, that means, of course, that if the atheist offers an argument in his behalf against the existence of God, he is going to have to support this. In court, theoretically, the defendant never has to say a word. He is presumed innocent, and it's up to the prosecution to show that he isn't. All right. So let's not embarrass ourselves. If we are offering the case for Christianity, then we need to offer the case for Christianity. Don't let the book title overwhelm you. The defense never rests. Actually, Parton is not primarily defending against arguments that other people have presented. He is offering positive evidence in behalf of the truth of the faith. By the way, he teaches on our program in Strasbourg, France, every summer. And if you go on that program those 2 weeks, you will be sitting under him, under me, under Professor Rod Rosenblatt of Concordia University, Irvine, who's a fabulous lecturer. And the fourth person is Dr. Oliver Wilder Smith, who is the son of the great A.E. Wilder Smith, who was one of the foremost opponents of philosophical evolutionary theory in the 20th century. And his son, who also has 3 doctorates, including medical doctorates, is handling scientific and medical apologetics on the program this summer.
So basically, there really isn't a good, I guess, counter defense to Christians' defense of Christianity. I think that's more what I was asking.
Okay, whether there are good counter arguments against the Christian position.
Right, I think that was more what I was trying to say, because if someone comes up to you upon hearing you're a Christian and just approaches you, well, why, blah, 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 but they have no defense for what they believe. You know, I wondered if there was anything
The chances are that the person like that who comes up to you has not done any reading or work in this area. If they have, they will have read these popular new atheist works. You need to have contact with that sort of thing so that you can properly answer that stuff. We have not been dealing with that today at all. That's one of the things that's on the program in the summer. We haven't, for example, gone into what the second law of thermodynamics and its implications for the existence of God and things like that, and we can't very well do it. But you do not, as a Christian, have to worry that the non-Christian has got some definitive argument and he's just waiting to smash you with this argument. The case for Christianity is overwhelmingly better than any of the attempts to refute it.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, thank you for talking today. I guess my question today is about infallibility a bit. If you get somebody to the point where they believe that Jesus was alive, that he was resurrected, how can you convince him that the words in the gospel are the actual words Jesus spoke himself and not just the evangelist putting words in Christ's mouth?
Well, since we were just talking about burden of proof, if a person says that what the eyewitnesses said Jesus said is not what Jesus actually said, the burden will be on that individual to show us what Jesus did in fact say and why one wouldn't trust what the eyewitnesses have to say. This is no different in any similar historical discussion. Somebody says that Napoleon said X, and this person has immediate contact with Napoleon, he listens to Napoleon, and he says Napoleon said X. Unless you have a better source that says that Napoleon didn't say X, he said Y, there's no point in even arguing the point. Do you see? Because we have to base this on evidence. And the only way you could get around that would be to try to show that those who recorded what Jesus said, allegedly recorded what Jesus said, had some reason for perverting it, or were too dumb to know what Jesus said, or were too psychologically deficient to be able to put down what he actually said. None of those things can be shown about those people. Those people were average, ordinary people who were obviously endeavoring to be as accurate as they could. Now, once you work this thing all the way through, you get something else. And I'm going to get into that tomorrow morning. Jesus gave a gift, a special gift, to his apostles. This gift is in the Gospel of John. He said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and he will bring to your remembrance all things whatsoever I have told you." Okay? Oscar Kuhlmann, the Swiss theologian, said this was the gift of total recall. We'd call it today total recall. And that's, of course, why the early church chose documents written by apostles or close associates of apostles to go into the New Testament, because that meant that the writers would have a reliable memory of exactly what Jesus said. Okay? So you will eventually get to the point, if you follow this line of argumentation, of seeing that this material rises above the level of just ordinary, accurate reporting.
Right. I guess I'm thinking of like Thucydides in reporting on Pericles' funeral oration.
Yes.
And that he's not making the argument, Thucydides himself, that these are actually Pericles' words. They're just something akin to what Pericles said. So then the argument is that it's a different book, because you can't really compare the Word of God to any other book, in a sense.
Well, I mean, ultimately you can't, but you don't start out that way.
Right.
You start out by viewing this as you would any other book, and what the writers say is, we have not followed cunningly devised fables, the Greek there is mouthoi, myths, when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We were eyewitnesses of his majesty. These people are claiming that they are getting exactly objective truth and presenting it to you as a record. And of course, if you don't think that's the case, it's a free country, you can believe anything you want to, but it certainly seems irrational when you weren't there to suggest that they weren't doing this accurately. If you had a better witness with different content, then you could certainly use this, but we don't have that. Our best information about Jesus is the stuff collected in the New Testament, and it was collected in the New Testament because it came from eyewitnesses or close associates of eyewitnesses. And that's all we require in historical scholarship in general.
Thank you.
Okay.
I recall we sat in Strasbourg and around a table and talked about this very subject.
Wasn't it fun?
Yes, it was.
Don't you encourage people here to sign up right away?
I definitely do. It's a great week. And I remember, Dr. Montgomery, we were talking about the relationship between law, gospel, and evidence and decision. C.F.W. Walther made the statement that if you properly preach law and gospel, you don't have to mention faith. Luther made the statement that hunger is the best cook. Now, if I'm starving and my wife sets a meal in front of me, she doesn't say to me, "Come on, man, make a decision whether or not you're going to eat." Let me finish.
Sure,
if
sure,
I'm
sure.
hungry, I'm going to eat. Now,
okay, from a preacher's standpoint, that is perfect.
I understand that.
Okay, okay.
But the relationship between law and gospel in apologetics, there has to be a point where you bring that person to the place where not only do they understand the evidence that we're dealing with a valid truth here, but that the law tells them they need this truth. So I don't think you can replace law and gospel with evidence and decision.
But do you think I was doing that? Didn't you hear the tail end of my presentation?
Yes, I did.
All right.
I heard it very clearly.
All right.
I hope you want to do that. If the law is preached properly, they will want to do that.
Look. If the law is properly preached, what it will do is to put them in a condition of despair and misery, existential angst.
And
they will realize they cannot save themselves.
Right.
But at that point, there are 35 different religious systems available in our society that offer some kind of answers to that, that will tell them, yes, you are miserable, but that's because you have not had contact with Gautama, the Buddha, and so forth. All right? And under those circumstances, what we need to do is to show this person who is in this state of angst and misery that Jesus Christ is, in fact, the answer over against these competing options.
Granted, but there is no other religion whereby the Holy Spirit works through the message to create faith.
Correct, but they don't know this because they're not Christian.
So you preach
the
message.
And therefore, if you simply expect that by preaching they are going to recognize that Christ is the answer, that is not necessarily true, because they're presented with a vast number of alternatives, and they need to be able to distinguish the truth from these alternatives. If they do, when they do come to Christ, only the Holy Spirit has produced
right.
this. But we are humble humans down here, and what we need to do is to preach and give the case for Christianity so that people see the difference between the alternatives and what's available here.
But the decision that you're talking about, faith, is faith decision.
Sure it is.
I think faith is...
What must I do to be saved?
Yeah.
Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. There Paul is saying to the Philippian jailer, you need to make a decision. You need to believe.
What if Paul would have preached the gospel? Would the Holy Spirit have created faith without him telling him you have to believe?
I'm not sure. You know, someone went to Augustine and said, what was God doing before he created the world? And Augustine said he was creating hell for people who ask questions like that.
At the beginning of your presentation, you asserted that the Gospels are internally coherent, internally consistent. Can you defend that assertion based on the synoptic problem and the discrepancies raised there?
Yeah, no problem at all. Take a look, for example, at a book done by the dean of the Boston University School of Law at the turn of the 20th century, The Four Gospels from a Lawyer's Standpoint, in which he goes into exactly this kind of thing. And the kind of reasoning that he uses is this. If the four Gospels said word for word the very same thing, it would be like two police witnesses who get up and they say exactly the same thing. I've had this kind of thing happen. And you know that this is collusion. What's happened is one of them took notes, then they worked on this together until finally they're saying exactly the same thing. This is simply collusive evidence and isn't worth very much. What you have in the case of the Gospels are four independent writers who have seen the events from four different viewpoints. It's like four different searchlights on the same events, and they will not be equally impressed by what the other person is impressed by. It's a situation where they will be putting down those things which they feel have the greatest impact for them, and also their purpose in writing. There are, for example, Gospel of Mark is undoubtedly written for a Gentile audience, and so you have a different kind of an approach than you do in the case of Matthew's Gospel. The issue is, when you have four writings like this, all about Jesus, all about his career, and they are not saying exactly the same thing, are they contradicting each other? And they aren't. They are complementary. Ever since the early days of Christianity, you have harmonies of the gospel that put this stuff together. And if they had been presenting contradictory stuff, again, the hostile witnesses would have blown the whistle on them, which certainly did not take place. And when the comment is made, well, look at the contradictions. The people who say this wouldn't know a contradiction if it came up and kissed them on both cheeks. A contradiction requires two stories which cannot be true at the same time under the same conditions. A frequent example of this that's often raised is that in the Synoptic Gospels, Jesus cleans out the temple at one end of his ministry, and in the Gospel of John, he cleans it out at the other end of his ministry. I'm surprised he didn't clean out the temple every Saturday night. It deserved it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Well, I had to come down here to keep this going because there's nobody else. Yeah, you know, we got to go until 4 o'clock, right?
Is that the only
right?
reason you've come
well,
up here?
That's one reason.
Just checking. Yes.
Another reason is I want to ask you a question. You used the term saved. What do you mean by saved? Saved from what?
Saved. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, saved from an eternity apart from God. Okay? Mm-hmm. Or saved for an eternity with God. Mm-hmm. Salvation is something that starts right here and it continues on forever.
The people that aren't saved, they just sort of die and just nothing happens to them, right?
Oh, is that what you're wondering about? Not according to Scripture. According to Scripture, people continue to exist, and they exist either in God's presence or out of God's presence. And out of God's presence is no fun. Mm-hmm. All right? C.S. Lewis has a very interesting presentation of this in one of his books. This is a train that's on its way to hell, right? And it arrives at the hell station. And already people are arguing with each other. And some of them say, well, we're better than they are. Let's us go and found our own city, our own community. And so you see people getting out of the train and they're going and founding cities. And there are a lot of these cities close to the train station. But then, of course, because the people who are on this train are utterly self-centered and selfish, the people in each of these cities start arguing with each other. And so they split. And the landscape of hell is a series of tightly packed cities close to the train station and sparser and sparser communities as you move away from the station. And finally, way out on the horizon, there are nothing but individual huts. And the single occupant of the hut is saying, I showed them. Huh? You know, which is a frightful kind of thought. But if self-centeredness is the thing, if that's the essence of sin, and self-centeredness is inherent in a fallen race, and we don't receive the salvation that Jesus has offered us, then isn't that logically where we would be ending up?
Now you're suggesting that people that aren't Christians are not saved?
Well, I'm talking about people who refuse the salvation of Christ.
In other words, if they don't refuse it, don't know about it, they might be saved, right?
Well, fascinatingly enough, I just did a little hypothetical article on this that appears in Christian News. Now, I realize that nobody ever mentions Christian News in a mixed group. But as a matter of fact, it's a very, very valuable paper. It really is. I mean, because it isn't conditioned by denominational bureaucracy. And therefore, you can often get information that you can't get anywhere else. And sometimes it's true. Anyway, this article deals with that question. And I hypothesize as follows. This is what is known as a scientific construct. That is to say, it is not something that is doctrine. It is simply an attempt to explain a difficult situation. All right? And therefore, it does not have to be accepted, but it might be helpful. And it goes like this. Just suppose that people who die without any opportunity to hear the gospel, you know, the person dies 10 minutes before the missionary reaches the village or something of this kind. Just suppose that at the instant of death, before the person passes into the next world and at the dividing line between this world and the next, at that point, by grace alone, the person were to meet Jesus Christ. And it were possible at that point either to move in his direction or not. Okay? If that were the case, that would not be a second chance because the person had never had a first chance, and it wouldn't be a sort of opportunity to change your situation in eternity because you never had that opportunity at all, and you aren't yet in eternity. You're on that thin line between this world and the next. If that were the case, it would be very helpful in dealing with non-Christians who try to argue that God is unjust because he is condemning people who never have a chance to hear. I am not presenting that as doctrine, of course. I cannot do that. It is only an attempt to explain a very difficult problem that is not defined in Holy Scripture. Okay? Now, don't you, anybody here, go out and start yelling that Montgomery is a heretic and he's saying that people are going to be saved regardless of Jesus Christ or something. Notice in my story here, my hypothetical, it is a person is saved only through Christ, and that's perfectly clear in Scripture. No man comes to the Father but by me, said Jesus. And the apostles in Acts say that there is none other name under heaven by which we must be saved than the name of Jesus Christ. So, okay.
We got another person here, so I can leave now.
Bye.
This is perhaps a sort of side question, but do you think there is something that inclines Jews to at least listen to Christianity and makes the idea of sort of Jewish evangelism more possible than I would ever have thought when I first heard about it? Is there something perhaps about Judaism, or let's put it this way, about the connection between Judaism and Christianity? I mean, they're aware that we include their Bible in our Bible.
Well, that certainly is the strongest common ground, isn't it?
Yeah.
That the Old Testament is Scripture to them and it's Scripture to us.
Right.
Yeah. On the other hand, Jewish evangelism is extremely difficult, owing to the fact that the persecutions of Jews, especially in medieval history, are part of the educational material that every Jewish child learns. Mm. And so there is a cultural block there which makes it very difficult for many Jewish people, in spite of the common Old Testament, to be willing even to listen to a Christian. I had in university, one of my classics professors was Harry Kaplan. And I tried to witness to him as an undergraduate, and he said, listen, he said, I am a Jew, and I will never become a Christian, and there's no sense in your even talking to me about this.
Hmm.
Huh? Which is very sad. And of course, I was too young and naive. I didn't press Kaplan by saying, you're a university professor. The purpose of universities is to find the truth, and the argument for the truth of Christianity is so overwhelming that you deserve to check this out. You can't just dismiss this on the basis of your background.
Hmm.
Yeah. Okay. I wish I could help more, but I can't.
Yeah, thank you. But I mean, I guess I'm sort of noticing I'm a retired university professor, and so, you know, just in academia you have contact with Jews, even though I was at St. Louis University.
You're finding them more open to Christianity now?
It seems to me that they sort of are aware of Christianity. I mean,
they can't not be aware of it in a sense because of the civilization in which they're operating.
But I guess I also wonder, I don't know that much about the medieval evils that we did towards the Jews, but it seems to me that that's, you know, a couple of hundred, those are hundreds of years ago. And
you're absolutely right. And when if a Jew in discussion with you is willing to bring up, let's say, Christian atrocities against the Jews, you make two points. The first point is, the people who did these things can't possibly have done them because they were Christian. If they were Christian, they would have acted like Jesus Christ, who was a Jew, and would surely not have treated the Jewish populations the way they did. So they were inconsistent with Christianity. It occurred in spite of Christianity, not because of it. And secondly, that has nothing to do with the truth issue anyway. Suppose somebody had caught Einstein shoplifting. Would that have meant that E didn't equal MC squared?
I also sort of wonder, now that I'm becoming more aware of the fact, for its first 1,000 years, Islam attacked Christianity and the Western world, and I sort of wonder whether that attack by Islam on Christianity came back on 9/11, whether that has, in some sense, built some commonality between Jews and
Christians.
Drawn
Jews and Christians together, maybe over against Islam. Well, it could well be. What I would want is, insofar as you can, in your discussions with either Jews or Mohammedans or whomever,
right,
always ask, after you've asked, what do you believe, always ask, why do you believe it?
Mm-hmm.
What's the support for it? And you'll be amazed at how little support there is for competing religious positions. And that opens the door for you to present Christianity and the remarkable historical and evidential support that exists for the truth of it.
Hmm. I think there's been, I mean, the 20th century has seen a lot of sort of, you know, Jews for Christianity, people like, say, Richard Wurmbrand and others.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I think this gentleman is going to be the last of the Mohicans.
All right. One final question.
Well, I would tell the gentleman just leaving the microphone that Dr. Scott Ganser is here this afternoon. He has extensive contact with Orthodox Jewish people, and Dr. Ganser would be a good person for this gentleman to speak to, get further information.
Excellent. If he didn't hear that or hasn't written it down, see him afterwards, okay?
All right.
Okay.
In a court of law, it seems to me that consistency is important regarding presentation of evidence. And you had a question earlier about, well, how can we know that what Jesus said is what he really said?
Mm-hmm.
And so, could you speak perhaps to the consistency of what Jesus said as he taught throughout the New Testament?
Yes, but you want to be careful about this, because the test of truth, there was a personalist philosopher at Boston University a couple generations ago, Edward Sheffield Brightman, E.S. Brightman, and Brightman said, the proper truth test is systematic consistency. That means that the assertion that you make needs to be internally consistent and fit the facts, right? Has to have those two characteristics. Problem is that occasionally things come up in which consistency and fitting the facts are in tension, in which both of these are not adequately satisfied. And the question then is, which trumps the other? And the answer to this is facts always trump consistency. Facts always trump consistency. Why is this? Well, I will conclude with my Uncle Elmo. Uncle Elmo is convinced that he is followed by Albanians, all right? And you say, Uncle Elmo, this is just getting out of hand. What about Schultz, the candy store owner who is a member of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, and he gives candy to children? Says Uncle Elmo, they're tricky, those Albanians. Now, Uncle Elmo is entirely consistent. He is a consistent paranoiac, what he has to say passes the consistency test. The trouble is, it doesn't pass the test of fitting the facts. Another reason for my caveat on this is that there are high matters of faith which can be justified on a factual basis, but where you're going to have a dreadful time trying to demonstrate internal consistency. The doctrine of the Trinity is one of these. Another is that a problem of the Holy Spirit saving those who are saved and people who are not saved, it's being their own fault. The will of man and the will of God. There are certain areas like that, high areas of metaphysics, where you're going to have a terrible job on the consistency front. But as long as the facts support this, you go along with it. And the scientist does the same thing. For example, if you subject light to two equally good series of experiments, it will come out both as particulate and undulatory. It's both a wave and a particle. And these are inconsistent. Waves don't have mass, and particles do. What do the scientists do? Do they split into two denominations and write against each other? No. They simply take the unit of light as the photon. And what is a photon? It's a wave hyphen particle. They don't understand how this is possible, but the evidence shows that you go in that direction. So if there's a problem with consistency, don't worry so much about that, unless you're a Calvinist. If you're a Calvinist, consistency is everything. Yes, but of course you're not, so we don't have to worry about that.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Montgomery.